I will ask our professors, actually, because they know better than me, to pose some questions to our guests. Because I think that in that interaction, we can get better overview what is going on in Sudan, and also perhaps some clues why is going on. So perhaps for the beginning, I will ask Professor Butcher to start with the perhaps questions from the, let's say, key actors which is missing in Sudan, and this is what is behind international community and such things. Please.
I am not sure to be the right person to answer this question. You have here two marvelous guests who maybe should say their own point of view of what is going on in Sudan. As far as I'm concerned, of course, Sudan is a country like many others with its weaknesses inside. And because of those weaknesses inside, it can be, of course, a playing ground for the big powers. Now, is that really so? I don't know. What I really wonder is why the European Union is not doing its own job. The European Union is very good around all around the world by its relief, aid relief. And it's basically one of the greatest donor in the world. And if the European Union does that, being a donor, I wonder why it is not more present in Darfur. And of course, now, who is the European Union? Is this a big bad wolf somewhere out there? No. The European Union is composed of states. And one of the states is Slovenia. So basically, we shouldn't ask what the European Union is doing. We should basically ask what Slovenia is doing.
Thank you. Perhaps I will give really now the word to our guest to try to answer those things. Yes. No, you need it. You
don't
have
need it
already.
Okay, then. Thank you. I think first thing I should say is that the Slovenians started the challenge of the conflict of Darfur in the era of the late president of this country, Mr. Janez Drnovšek. Until then, they are still in the lead in Europe. But let me start with the conflict itself, how it started, and what are the causes. Sudan got independent in 1956. There were some families around the colonial administration. And when the independence came, those who were around the colonial administration inherited the country from the administration, the colonial administration, and they insist that Sudan belongs to those minority, not more than 5% in the center, and they belong to a small number of families. And the others, the 95%, are all marginalized. Our fellow citizens from the south, since 1955, and they start rebelling, fighting for their rights since the independence, until in 2011, they got independence and they have their country. We as Darfurians started to rebel against this, but politically, since 1960. We formed some kind of resistance group named Hell. Then it was promoted to Red Flame, then promoted to Sunni, related to an area in Jabal Marra, and then it was promoted to Darfur Development Front in 1964-65. Since then, and even the Darfurians attempt some kind of military coup in 1977, and they failed. And in 1975, also they failed. So the conflict is based on this kind of. Then the counterattack from the center, they tried to implement some kind of divide and rule. They divided the population in all over Sudan on two categories, Arab-rooted tribes and the African-rooted tribes. The Arab-rooted tribes were minority. So they sent, they immigrated Arab nomads from the neighboring countries to the west, like Chad, Nigeria, Niger, and Cameroon, and they equipped them and encouraged them to evacuate the land of the Africans on the indigenous tribes who are living in Darfur. So it became some kind of someone who is trying to drive me out of my country or my land, and those who are defending their countries. So it is a defensive war since it started, and the conflict cannot be solved unless people address the root causes of the conflict and stop the center from implementing this kind of divide and rule policy. And those who are longing to inherit the country or the land should stop their. And it is, I'm speaking about Darfur. Darfur is like as wide as France for the Europeans to know. Only Darfur is even bigger than France. And the population that Darfur is, who are consisting of Arabs and non-Arabs, it is not more than 8 million. So the land is enough to host us, all of us. But the newly immigrated want to a wider area because of their livestock to find pastoralists, to find some areas to host their livestock. For that, this conflict, unless people go to the deep root causes of the conflict, will not be solved. Then the European Union. By the help of the Slovenians and the Slovenian representatives in the European Union Parliament, I visited the European Parliament twice, July 2010 and yesterday. I'm sorry to say, if you just subtracted Slovenia from Europe, all over Europe, I think they accepted the backseat of the Americans. And they are ready to implement whatever Americans say. Americans, in our history, they have twice failed us. In 2006, when they pressed the peace deal of Abuja, they were in the middle term examinations and they want something to raise it in front of the voters in their country. And the man who was mandated to come and to represent United States was longing to chair the International Bank. So they pressed the peace deal without addressing the root causes, and we told them this will not last on the ground, and it was dead. The second day it was signed, and they know it. And despite that, they just, because their interest is to have a paper and to say to the voters in America that we have sponsored some kind of a peace deal in Sudan, and this is an achievement. And the man was gifted the chair of the International Bank. Again, in 2011, they also pressed another peace deal. The only thing that they can get as a benefit, until now they are insisting that they have created a peace deal. I think Obama's period, midterm elections are due. So they are now speaking about a peace deal they implemented or they sponsored in Doha, Abuja, Doha in Qatar. And the man who was also mandated to come and to represent United States, former general in their army, and he was longing to be the ambassador of United States in Nairobi, and he got the job, and that is all. For Europe, I spoke to the parliament in 2010, and I told them, we need, you are neighbors. Only this Mediterranean Sea is between us. In place of leaving us to the interests of the Americans and the Chinese fighting over their interests in our land, why don't you come bear with your own identity and appear in the scenes? I think a lady spoke here in the film, was a member, and she accepted my criticism, and she said that yes, we accept what Americans think of the things, and we don't have our own policy. Still, they don't have their own policy. If Europe is represented by Slovenia, yes, I can say Europe is doing the best possible, but it is only Slovenia. It started with the late President Drnošek and carried out Tomo Krizner, Klemen Mihalic, Bocian Bidomšek, and Marijana Vončina, and Ivo Weigel in the parliament. They say sometimes, we are a small country and we are a small nation, and I say that you are still a country and you have your own chair in the United Nations, and you have, so don't undermine yourself. You have your own flag and your own voice. So what I am longing to say is, for me to have someone, if even a small country, to speak on your voice and to carry out your case is better than nothing. So if I am to bleed, I bleed Slovenians, don't drop the challenge. Thank you.
Thanks. Tomo, perhaps you can also add some your experience or your perception as human rights worker, you know, how do you interact with such things like, you know, state, then European Union and other actors in behind? Or if this situation somehow changed from the beginning you started to work there? And
okay, začeli smo praktično 1998. leta, ko so bili samo 3-4 aktivisti, ki so skušali pomagati takrat v vojni protko marginaliziranim nubam v Južnem Kordofanu. To so bili Julia Flint, Alex Deval, Peter Možinski, v glavnem ti trije. No? In kad ste lahko videli iz filma, smo imeli ravno s tistim prvim filmom Nuba čisti ljudje velik uspeh. Takrat je bilo mogoče nekaj, kar se zdaj skoraj ne da več. Ne vem, kam gredo časi, ne vem, kam je trend, ampak takrat smo lahko pritegnili vso slovensko javnost, večino Evrope, plus Ameriko. Recimo, ko je naš film dobil nagrado za najboljši dokumentarec v Telluride v Colorado, so ameriški aktivisti začeli VHS kasete kopirati in kad ste lahko videli v filmu, ne bi se izkazal Daniel Lupinski, v tisočih bombardirati inštitucije po Ameriki, od teh za pravice Afričarov, črncev, no, v Združenih državah, do Indijancev, med drugim so zadeli poleg Oprah tudi State Department in takrat tegale Georgia, Johna, poseben Bushov odposlan za Sudan, Danforda, in ta je šel potem osebno pogledati, da je to res. To je bilo takoj po 11. septembru, dobro, 11. september je odigral pomembno vlogo, pustimo zdaj zakaj, zakaj jaz mislim, da je bil zelo pomemben, ampak povrnitvi je v kongresu, sorry, I should speak in English, you can understand, sorry, sorry. After he returned, John Danforth, from Nuba Mountains, he said, we have to change the American politics. We have to start helping in the center, not in the south, because the problem of Sudan can be solved from the center, from the Nuba Mountains, from the South Kordofan. And this really worked. There was 100 different military observers from different countries. Slovenia was not invited into this club. And I met them in 2002, in 2003, happily protecting the Nuba. The government of Sudan was at that time very scared that there will be another war proposed on them, not just these other neighboring countries. So they didn't dare to touch these observers, more than 100 observers. Okay, later I heard that they've been digging for minerals, they've been using the helicopters to settle on the tops of the mountains, and you know, they always do this, nothing special, but we did, we succeeded to protect. Now it's impossible. We succeed only to get the main journalist, as you saw in the film in June, from Guardian, from BBC, from Al Jazeera, from Times, New York Times, but now, to repeat even what we succeed in last summer to Blue Nile, where is the situation even worse than in Nuba. It's impossible. Even my friend activist said that you cannot do nothing because this is completely lost case. The government of Sudan is exterminating and killing these people because we took it to the south. We allowed him to do it this. So the whole world politics is ready to not see that there is genocide happening in Blue Nile from September 1st. Yeah, even my friends activists. So the world is going down. It's more and more in the hands of the I think, corporations, which are stronger than, because they are international, than the national governments. And ha. We are all, what we are doing here, I believe, we are to protect our own children. It's to protect the humanity, the values of the humanity, which was capable with these values to survive hundreds of thousands of years. I think we are fighting for our children. It's very serious. I don't know how much you are aware what's going on in Africa, but look, they are just two main powers, actually. One is China, and another one is the Anglo-Saxon and Jewish connection. These people are the only really interested. Europe is looking away. So that's why we went to to the parliament yesterday, and we quite openly asked for help, and the Slovenian representatives promised. Yesterday, about 7:30 in the evening, we got promise that they will try to get resources for video control, video surveillance of these border areas, because as we can see, this is helping more than UN or any other force, I believe. So that's why I come here today also to be present on this projection, although I believe I already said everything in this film, to ask you, the grassroots and the professionals, to support this, if you humans. We need to do that. Do you want still looking these people dying? Can we wake up from this comfort, from this corruption, common corruption, which is coming from the wrong connection or relationship with the nature? That's what I believe. If we would have a good enough relationship with the nature, we would know that these people are innocent, yeah? And they are just one of the last examples of once long conquered indigenous people. We Europe have our own blood on the fingers because of these processes, yeah? We should not forget that we are rich because we stole so much land, so much gold, now petrol and other natural resources. So as you see, I'm very ready to fight, yeah? I will not throw bombs, but I will do more films. I'm going back again, yeah? I will put cameras on all this line. If you will support this, yes, of course. You are our power. You are our power foundation. Okay. It's impossible, to conclude, to do the same as before through institutions. My experience is that they are now even more corrupted than 15 years or 10 years ago. So that's why I'm calling everyone who is still sensitive before it will be too late.
Thank you. Perhaps we can also open some, let's say, more security related issues, and Professor Bebler.
We have seen films of footage of various kinds of footages from several areas in Sudan. Speaking legally in the Republic of Sudan, in Jamahiriya of Sudan, and in the Republic of South Sudan. Nowadays, these are two separate states. There is some footage from the province of Darfur, from the area of Darfur, which is located legally in Sudan, the Republic of Sudan. And there is footage from two border areas, border meaning that the border between the Republic of Sudan and the Republic of South Sudan has not been determined. And it's unclear whether the Nuba Mountains belong to either of this side. And there is an agreement to hold possibly a referendum, the word which has been used in an agreement concerning the Abia province, that there will be some popular questioning or popular inquiry on the will of the people, of the population of that area, which lies right between the two states, but more to the north than to the south. Whether the population of this area, of that area, would prefer to join the Republic of South Sudan, or whether it would prefer to stay the way it is in the Republic of Sudan. And there is footage from Nile, from Blue Nile region. These are very different situations, first of all. One should not mix them. They are very different. In the case of Darfur, there is a mixture of internal clashes within Darfur between two basically groups of population in Darfur, and a military intervention or military operations led by more or less by the armed groups supported by the central government from Khartoum. Basically, these are military operations by the central government in Khartoum against one part of the population of Darfur. It's one situation. So it is an internal armed conflict within a territory of a member state of the United Nations. Partly it is a civil war, partly it's a war, waged by the central government against a part of a very substantive part of the population of those 8 million. And there is a very large group of refugees from Darfur on the other side of the border in Chad. So it's another situation that involves several hundred thousand refugees from Darfur, which are camped in camps on the Chad territory. Again, it's another question of relations between the two states and the question of the role of the international community in trying to alleviate the sufferings of the refugees and solve the problem of refugees, of either returning them to Darfur or providing them with some means to survive. Now, as far as the province of Abyei is concerned, the situation is such that there is, and now, a real interstate war, the war between two states and their armed forces. It's not a civil war. It's a war between the military forces of the central government in Khartoum and the Sudan People's Liberation Army, which is an official armed force of the Republic of South Sudan, for the control of that contested area. The area is important because it's one of the largest oil fields is located exactly in that area. In spite of an agreement between the two sides, between Khartoum and the leadership of the Liberation Front in South Sudan, in spite of an agreement that there will be, and an agreement was reached 5-6 years ago, to hold a kind of a referendum in the Abyei area, there was constant postponing of that referendum. Basically, the holding of referendum was blocked by the central government in Khartoum. And the central government, without waiting for the results of this questioning, occupied the area in June 2011, just before the proclamation of independence of Southern Sudan, in order to preempt the peaceful resolution of that conflict. From June 2011, until March of this year, the most important oil fields were under control of the Khartoum of the central government. As I understand, 2 weeks ago, the army of Southern Sudan was able to recapture the area.
2 days?
Yes. Oil fields were occupied. They are occupied now by the army of Southern Sudan. And of course, due to this interstate war, they are suffering, they are victims. Of course, there is a very substantive difference in strength and in equipment and arms which are being used by the two armies. The army of Sudan, central government, is much better armed, it is more professional, and the greatest difference is that it uses bombers, it uses aviation, air force, against civilian population, but also against the army of Southern Sudan. So it's a very uneven struggle. And of course, most of the victims, and we've seen some of this footage, the victims among the civilian population were actually killed, murdered by the Air Force of the Republic of Sudan, just by bombing. They say Antonov, not necessarily Antonov. There were some other planes, I suppose, some other bombers, because the Antonovs are not typical bombers. All right. Now, the situation in Nuba Mountains is again a different one. And there are some other complications. Yes, there were, as I calculated, 38 years of civil war between the North and the South in Sudan. From 1955 until 1971, and from 1972, 31 years of the war, which was a war between the army of central government in Khartoum, Sudan, and Sudan People's Liberation Army, organized by the legendary leader Garang, unfortunately, late Garang. All in all, 37 years of civil war. No one knows, and no one will never know, the total number of victims. There is an estimate that at least 2.5 million people were killed. 2.5 million. And about 5 million were made refugees, displaced persons, external and internal. 5 million. After 38 years of civil wars. And that was a war between a central government and rebels, insurgents. This is a situation of a civil war. Now, with the proclamation of the Republic of Sudan, the level of armed struggle between the North and the South has been reduced. It's still going on in those two provinces, as I mentioned. But there is something else, which is not covered and which is not shown here. The Republic of Southern Sudan has 10 provinces. In those 10 provinces, there are still today armed conflicts with many civilian victims in 9 out of 10 provinces. And these armed conflicts are between the army of official army of Republic of South Sudan and local forces. They are altogether 7 military formations led by warlords, tribal chiefs, who fight the authorities, the newly established authorities of the Republic of South Sudan. 7 in 9 provinces. This is the situation of a typical civil war. And it's very difficult to estimate how many people are being killed in what kind of an armed conflict. Now, the international community has been developing a doctrine which is called the doctrine of responsibility to protect. Who could effectively apply this doctrine in cases like Sudan? Few states and very few international organizations. The United Nations certainly have no strength for that. They cannot do it. The African Union is too poorly organized and internally politically divided. We saw it when a civil war was started in Libya. We saw the position of the African Union. The African Union refused to come to help to the insurgents and to the victims, civilian victims, of the Gaddafi regime in Benghazi. The African Union. The Arab League is also divided. It is divided now over what to do about the victims, civilian victims in Syria. Very deeply divided. the only force, international force, which could effectively stop the killing on a mass scale in the world today is one organization which Tom O'Krishnan doesn't like. And that organization is called NATO. The West. The Western powers alone are both capable and occasionally willing to apply the doctrine. Occasionally. And very selectively. The Russian Federation doesn't like it. Doesn't apply it. China despises it. Although it could. It has the capacity. And so it goes. And if we look at it, what happened in the last 2 years, for instance, or last 12 years, the Western powers basically, have used and applied the doctrine, the responsibility to protect, the so-called humanitarian intervention, basically in 2 cases, or in 3 cases. In Bosnia and Herzegovina, 1994, 1995, in Kosovo, 1999, and in Libya, 2011, only 3 cases. In how many places in the world it would be nice and morally right to apply the doctrine, to stop genocide, to stop mass extermination of local population like in Darfur, to stop other kinds of grave violations of human rights by the government, against the civilian population. I could easily enumerate you at this moment 30, 40, 50 countries where such intervention would be appropriate, morally appropriate. Unfortunately, it's legally impossible. And basically, where it would be possible, there is no willing on the part of those who can do it militarily to implement the doctrine. There are various reasons why, in one case like in Libya, the West is willing to intervene and stop the killing. In another case, where there are even more, there have been more civilian victims than in Libya, and that's in Syria, or in Sudan. The West is not willing. The West is not willing. Hence, if there is no external force which could stop the kind of genocide that is being that has taken place, still being taking place in Sudan, if there is no external force, the only solution is an internal solution. An internal solution of relationship between various groups, various political formations, now between the two states, which have partly normalized their relations, established even diplomatic relations, but still remain in a conflict over many things. Over the control of oil fields, over the division of the proceeds from exports of oil, over the control of all oil pipelines, over the plans to develop oil industry in Sudan, and so goes. So there is a combination of various factors, and unfortunately the appeals for moral support would do nothing. They would not. What you do, Toma, is very nice. It's very moral. I like it. But it does not produce results. It cannot produce results. The influence of public opinion, which will be aroused by this film, will not move the situation. Unfortunately, I would love it to see it happen. It is. You should be highly commended for what you are doing. It's a bit foolish, but yeah, it's up to you. And the donations the donations for this kind of activity, for, you know, buying or diffusing all those and distributing those small cameras. Makes no sense. I don't believe that
yes.
They produce any effect.
You will. Okay. Now it's your turn.
I think it's good to have someone who has such amount of knowledge of what is happening in Sudan all over. And thank you at least for following the conflict of Sudan. First thing I think I have to say, this war between the two countries is planned for in the implementation of the CPA, the Comprehensive Peace Agreement, and from the center itself. Just because of this plan, they delayed the demarcation of the borders, and they are not going to do it. And all the, what we call fights in Sudan are very similar to each other, starting from that of 1955, and then come to Darfur, then Nuba Mountain, then Blue Nile. All are based on deprivation of the human rights. Yes, Darfur is built in Chad, Nuba Mountain is built in the newly created country, and Blue Nile is built in Ethiopia. So refugees over everywhere, similar. And you touched that, what is the opinion of the population? The opinion of the population is not respected by the center. They will not consult them. They know what they are doing, they know their plans, they are implementing their plans. If we are asked in Darfur, like our conflict, we all, the ethnicity groups, Arab-rooted, African-rooted, the land is enough to host all of us. But the implementation of the policy of divide and rule, and the newly immigrated nomads, this is the conflict. Then, for the project camera surveillance, I don't share your opinion, because the international community is paying money to host a force of 20,000 troops, and their mandate is to protect the civilians. These 20,000 troops are ill-equipped, ill-trained, and they are ignorant of what is going on in the land, and the land is as wide as France, I said. So they are doing nothing, and now they are in need of who to protect themselves. When the day we announced that there are hidden cameras to photo or to trap the perpetrators of crimes, we did not announce the number of the cameras. We did not tell who has these cameras. We told that all the vulnerables are equipped by hidden cameras. The violation against the children and the women stopped promptly for over 6 months. And now, the if we don't have these cameras, we don't have this, what we call internet, you cannot hear about what is going on there. We need these cameras, this internet, to at least to send Arab news to the world. My conflict, if heard, for me it's better than if I'm compelled to walk on foot to spread the news. That will not happen over a year. But on the spot, if there is what we call the rebels, not the fight between, they shot down an unmanned aircraft a week ago, the same evening, we saw the picture in the internet. That is illustration of our news. We need it, and we need to tell the world that we need this, despite the benefit we get from the hidden cameras of protecting our civilians. We need the internet to tell the world that there is something wrong happening day by day. So I think to have somebody just feel sympathy with you is better than not to have everybody. So the video surveillance and the hidden cameras as of no value for us, because this is the only gate through which we can say to the world that there is something wrong going on. European Union. Now, Sudan is getting the biggest relief aid in the world. But it is coming through the government. And the biggest, what they call military force for protection of civilians is in Sudan, in all over the world. But it is ill-equipped. So everything there is put in an area where it should not be. For that, we need to regulate this. And if the center is playing on the contradictions between China and America, if this fight is stopped, we can solve our problem on the table, or on military basis. We can do this. This is, I'm telling you, we fought in Darfur for 8 months, for 8 years. Now we are in Kordofan, a step towards the center. Tomorrow we will be in White Nile, which is the second step towards the center. Blue Nile is away. I'm going to the White Nile, which is border with the Khartoum province. We are going this way, and we can do it. If even the conflict between what we call China and America is continued, we will solve our problem either way, either on the table or on military base on the land. Thank you.
Tomo.
Gospod Bibler, res v vsem spoštovanju, by my all respect, with my all respect, Mr. Bibler, let I ask you a question. When you have been last time in the war zone? Where, when, how long ago, how many years ago you have been last time with the victims who are coming and asking you for protection? With the children coming to you asking, please don't let me die. How long, how many years ago was this?
The question is irrelevant for this topic. Absolutely irrelevant. Only because you were there, your action is not any more effective. You cannot do anything.
You can do something. We've done it, and we are doing this. You are sitting in institution.
What is the effect?
it is, the fact is that we are getting the movie stars, the famous people like George Clooney. It has effect in public opinion. We got the famous Nicholas Kristof, who is now creating an opinion in America. Okay, maybe this will be all used for the for their national interests, yes, of the states in the Sudan, but maybe
don't fight. I want to add something. Please, I want to add something. Tumors effect. For us as victims, we appreciate it, and we are getting benefit of it. How can you say that it's going nowhere? No, it's effective. It's effective on the land with us, and we see it and we sense it.
Are there any of those victims now?
Yes, because of the films, because of the news spread.
No more.
Just stop.
Atrocities, yeah? Atrocities like cutting the womb of the mothers, taking out the children, putting the children on the posts. Because they don't dare to do the worst atrocities. Because they are scared to be filmed by this. This was happening a lot before, yeah? Rape is a common tool to exterminate the Africans from their homes.
I believe that.
To say that there is no effect.
I believe that there is a conflict in, let's say, the conceptualization of politics. Professor Beverly is talking about the politics on the state level. You are talking global or what? Mainly interstate level. You are talking about the politics which is relevant for the people. And I believe that in this case, for people to do something, even against the will of the state, perhaps they will not change so much in interstate conflicts, but nevertheless, they will change the situation on the ground. And otherwise, you know, there is just, you can just wait and do nothing, but perhaps it's better to do something. At least you can even die more dignity than in other ways when you do nothing against the power which is there also because we are supporting it. So I believe this is the problem. But now I hope that we can also turn, let's say, from high politics to more, let's say, what was said sometimes, low politics. On one side, the question of development. On the other side, the question of, let's say, media effects and technology effects, or how it's possible to use in both sides or in both directions also technology. So I will give now, firstly, the floor to Professor Maya Butcher and then Marco. It should work.
Yeah, it does work. Well, I can't really move down to the local level because of the economics in this case is really much more global than one could consider. You know, you really can't say this is grassroots development that you can start talking about. I read a speech around the Declaration of Independence of South Sudan where somebody was commenting that now finally we have come to our senses that only through cooperation both the South and the North Sudan can benefit in economic terms more than through the years of civil fights. With the events that you showed on this film and with the events of yesterday and a few months ago, it seems that this was really understatement. So it seems that the prevalent logic of, you know, we will be better in economic terms if we stop fighting has not come down to the Sudanese conflicts, be whatever group we put them. Am I correct in saying this?
Okay, another question perhaps, better okay. to pose both. Mm. Marco.
Okay, we have seen, is this working? Yeah. We have seen very strong reaction from both Slovenian media and Slovenian politics. On the other hand, we have seen very limited reaction from international politics organizations and from international media. So since I come from the area of journalism, I'd like to ask you about your strategy in the area of media and communicating, not just media, but communicating through the internet. We have seen in the film that you've had difficulties of reaching people like of Bernard Lin, Henry Levy, of Václav Havel, and so on. We have seen that there is very little or limited reaction from global media like Guardian and so on in this aspect. On the other hand, we have seen a lot of reaction to celebrities like George Clooney and so on. I have checked a couple of websites and seen two articles in The Guardian alone in the last week about Clooney and about the satellite control. So I'm wondering, is there perhaps a problem of communicating what you're doing? Is there this lack of response from international media also a reflection of perhaps lack of professional support in this area, in public relations or with communicating with the journalists? And just one more thing, we have seen the video, online video that has gone viral in the last few weeks of what was going on in Uganda. So is something like this possible in the case of Sudan, and why has this not happened before?
Can I say first? I believe the main problem which we are facing is the thinking of bureaucrats like, Professor Bibler. That's what we are facing everywhere. This generation is thinking like that. And we are like kicking the wall with our heads. It's very difficult to affect you, because you have no more heart and spirit, I believe. I'm sorry, but you people are sitting in institutions and are paid to do something. I believe you are here for more than just taking salary and pension. So you should activate yourself. Come with us now. See these victims. I believe you will change. I believe you will start with us. You will go with us. You will stay like this, even with not any protection, under the bombs falling down. And I believe you will do with your death something positive. They will say Professor Bibler died in Blue Nile. We are now planning to take a celebrity like Angelina Jolie. She's a goddess. She can do so much. And sometimes she's ready. Yeah. So please join us. It's not so dangerous as it looks. It's really not so dangerous. We forced United Nations to come to Nuba Mountains. You know, with the first film, Nuba Pure People, we have first problem here in Slovenia, because the Slovenian UNICEF said, yeah, but you are accusing us that we are collaborating with the government. Yes, you are collaborating with the government of Sudan, because you are saying that you cannot give the aid to the civilians under protection or under commandment or control of SPLA in Nuba Mountains. You are just giving this aid to the civilians which are controlled by the Sudan army forces. In the situation of Hanga, this means that you are giving munition to the one side, but not to the other side. So yes, you are guilty to cooperate in genocide. That's what Yusuf Kua say in our film. If you listen carefully, he accused United Nations to cooperate with the enemy. So I believe truly that it's the similar situation now. They are these heads, structures, no, of thinking, which must be changed. Then things will open. They call it this, I think, head, what's the name? Anyway, I believe, because I saw it and I experienced, that once the critical mass it's succeeded, once the people start thinking that the war should not be happening, there are conditions to change. And I think that we need put attention to Africa, because there are horrible things happening in the darkness, in the heart of darkness. So if we open the light, doesn't matter with the starlights, with the starshine, doesn't matter how, we could maybe sacrifice a movie star like Angelina Jolie. That would be very, very, very effective and productive, yeah?
On poor Angelina.
7 billion people on this planet for the sake of these children.
I am not Angelina Jolie. I am not going to join.
Okay, it doesn't matter. I think on economic basis, I think if I am compelled to buy ammunition to use against an enemy, and that was spared for me, I can build a school. So definitely, since war stops, there is at least extra money to be used for development, and this is, I think, obvious. Our strategy is to keep hammering on our conflict. What we cannot achieve today, we sense and we need to hammer on it until we achieve it someday. As the Chinese say, the journey of 1,000 miles starts with a step. We are not leaving our conflict. We will stay hammering and trying to get any support from anyone in the world, whoever he is. We don't differentiate between people, journalists, activists, and stars of the communities. Anyone we can address and we can speak to him. He believes us, he acts or not, it's not what we are, just if he has his time or she has a time to hear from us, we are ready to speak to everybody. So this is the way of hammering on our conflict. Then, if we speak about the tribal differences between us, we don't feel it until the implementation of the policy of divide and rule. We were living together. And we can go back and live together again. But the new immigrated, what we call community, should be stopped, should be terminated somewhere, so that they should not affect our life. Like the effect of our conflict in the world. Václav Havel, I traveled from here to Czech Republic to meet him. And we failed because he was not present in the country that day. Unfortunately, he died before I can find the chance again to go back. But in 2006, there was a group of consisting of Václav Havel, Desmond Tutu, and Judy Williams, which is, she got what you call Peace Prize. What is the name of Peace Prize?
Nobel Prize,
because of her role in banning the landmines. And Richard Holbrook, Julie Flint, Alex DeWall, 11 intellectuals from the whole world, they made an appeal and sent to Omar al-Bashir to solve the problem of Darfur and release me from jail. So the international role is there. Just we need to widen it, we need to spread it. And when I went to Czech Republic, if it comes that I find Václav Havel, I want just to say thank you for your role in our conflict in Darfur. And I failed to go there, but I met the others, like Julie Flint and Alex Dewal, and the American lady, which I named. I met them all, and we feel that there is raising of awareness in our conflict. And the conflict is going on, and we will keep on hammering on all the areas where we can get any kind of knowledge or benefit or sympathy even. To what is happening between Uganda and Sudan, and the relations between the two countries, the two Sudan countries. Since the policy of the center is to destabilize the South, I don't think relations are entitled to be tightened. Uganda is more or less supporter of the South Sudan. I'm sorry if I did not touch one of your questions.
I wasn't actually talking about the role of Uganda in the conflict in Sudan, but only about the viral video that was made about the political situation in Uganda and Kobe that was...
Medical?
Video that...
Kony.
Yes.
How much attention did you get to
Kony is an enemy of the West, and I think they sent 1,050 troops, special troops, to hunt him in the forest. So if the media appear, it will just be the opinion of the Westerners. And Joseph Kony have made atrocities against the civilians. We don't back him, we don't support him, but the intervention of the West in this conflict, I don't think that it will get any benefit for the because the day they landed there, they killed George Ator, who is the one of the rebels against the South Sudan government. And fortunately, I was there. And I don't want to get very far with the assessment you made in the South. The only conflict now, tribal conflict in the South, is between Dinka and the Latuka, Latuka, and the Dinka plus Nuer overraid on cattle, only not political, and the government of South Sudan all went there to stop this conflict between the two tribes. So this is the only conflict now is existing in South Sudan. I was there for a month. I was in Juba, in Bor, the center of the conflict in, and there are efforts, local civilian efforts between the two tribes to put things right, and then the government is covering that those efforts. So luckily, except the policy of destabilization of the North, I think South is more entitled to be stable more than the North itself. Kony will, I don't think that just 1,050 troops can capture him soon, he will survive for some time. Sorry for that, but this is a fact.
So, if anyone feels any need to pose any further questions, no. In that case, I would like to thank our guests and perhaps answer one question. I believe that this new technology and those things we are doing with media actually somehow they are a substitute for one of the means which are regularly used by states within peaceful resolution of conflicts, fact-finding. Fact-finding is very important. Without facts, you cannot do things. And with facts, actually, you can press, or they are part of the resolution, even the peaceful resolution of the conflicts. So if this is now possible to spread and not just use, let's say, international organizations to pose some fact-finding mission or something like that, I believe this is also, let's say, something which opens this part of international politics, at least this part. And with that, I would thank you, and our public also for the patience. Thank you.